And the reason why we are going to talk on liver transplant is because organ transplant is in a lot of news in the papers recently. And hospitals are really marketing organ transplant as the future of medicine. It's a good thing that is occurring. Definitely, it's very nice. But what we need to do is we need to find the right candidate for a transplant. Most of the times, and very often I've come across that a lot of patients are getting transplanted when it's not indicated. And that's the reason why I'm taking this topic, very controversial topic, because I'm going almost anti the crusade of transplant that is right now in the market. Now, when do you do a liver transplant? There are certain indications where you would do a liver transplant when you have an acute and chronic liver disease, which is going into a liver cell failure. You have a fulminant hepatic failure. An acute hepatitis going into a fulminant hepatic failure. Probably a hepatocellular carcinoma that's not coming under control. So you have various causes of liver transplant that you would be actually touching them on. Whenever you identify a candidate for liver transplant, what is important is it's going to be a live donor transplant in cases of children. It's not a cadaveric transplant as yet in India. So it's a live donor transplant. So you have to be very careful because somebody from the family is going to donate the liver. It has to be a blood relation. The donor has to be healthy, not with any heart disease, diabetes, all those are contraindications, or a healthy donor. Some centers have a cutoff of 60 years, some centers have a cutoff of 65 years on the donor. But blood relation is important. Nobody else can donate the liver. So, and it's a live donor, so you don't want to put the risk onto the donor when you're taking a transplant. Blood group is matching is the criteria. HLA matching is not the criteria. So the donor's blood group and the recipient's blood group should be matching. That's the only criteria for a liver transplant. Unlike in bone marrow transplant where you're doing an HLA matching.
Why HLA is not required?
It's not required here because blood group is enough. The chances of rejection is much less with you. Just a blood group match is enough. Now, we are going to discuss in the form of cases. So we are going to take one acute and chronic, and these are all the cases that have come to me as referrals. This girl came in April 2013, 11 years old girl from Rajasthan. She presented with jaundice for a month, and she had anasarca for 15 days. She's had 3 episodes of jaundice in the past. So you know that this is acute on chronic liver disease. In Rajasthan, she was investigated, her hepatitis B was negative. ANA was negative and the slip lamp for KF ring was negative. When I examined her, I couldn't find the liver. So the liver was shrunken, it was cirrhotic. There was splenomegaly ascites, so she had gone into portal hypertension. And she was deeply jaundiced, so she was definitely going into a liver cell failure. I advised her hospitalization, but they refused. Now, the same night, she had 3 episodes of hematemesis. So she came to Nanavati, she got admitted. She came straight to the ICU. She had tachycardia, shock, fever of 102 and drowsiness. She was given IV fluids, antacids, antibiotics for a suspected peritonitis, vitamin K, plasma, N-acetylcysteine, hepamers, all that. Shock, for the shock, she required dopamine. We couldn't do a scopy for the hematemesis because she was in a poor condition at that time. 24th April, her ammonia, all the reports came. And what you see is a bilirubin is 10, which is pretty high. For the kind of jaundice and the kind of state that she came, her enzymes were not that high. So it's almost a liver that is not functioning now. And her albumin is 1.9. Others, she had a few pus cells in the urine, so probably that was a cause of her infection. Specific investigation-wise, when we did, copper was low, ceruloplasmin was low, but that can occur with any fulminant liver disease or disease that is failing. Her hepatitis A, HBsAg, HCV, all were negative. Alpha fetal protein was normal. She had an ANA weekly.
Wilson's.
ANA was weekly positive, but other autoimmune markers were negative. Her immunoglobulins were normal, and she had a 24 hours urine copper, which we had sent was pending. So our differential at that time was either she's an autoimmune liver disease or she's a Wilson's disease. 25th April, her sensorium improves, but she starts getting decreased urine output. The creat starts rising. We start her on albumin, we do a Doppler, she's cirrhotic liver, portal hypertension, collaterals with ascites. Now the chart that I want to show you is, in the LFT when I mentioned, I didn't mention the PTINR to you. I just mentioned the bilirubin. What is important for you to know, for any liver disease, never neglect a PTINR. With this bili of 10, we would have said, okay, it's not that bad. But what is important is INR is 4. So that tells you that the first thing in any liver dysfunction to get deranged is the coagulation. So the PTINR gets deranged. And you can see over a period of time from 24th night to 28th, her INR never improved at all, in spite of giving her plasma. Her INR always remained around three. Bilirubin started rising, it went up, enzymes started falling. So the liver was not functioning at all. Now this is a candidate who needs an urgent liver transplant. She may not even survive without a liver transplant beyond a week. So we spoke to the parents about liver transplant. Now they've come from out of state. There are some state regulations also when you're going to do a liver transplant. So they said they wanted to go to Delhi because Delhi is nearer from Jaipur. And the donor would fly from Delhi to Jaipur to Delhi. But the problem was the child was in such a shape that we could not transport her to Delhi. There was no way we could have airlifted her because airlifting would have cost another 5 lakh rupees. So we told them, get the donor here, we'll manage to get a transplant done here. So the grandmother flew down for the transplant and we stabilized her. We made sure her ammonia was okay, her sensorium was okay, her kidneys were functioning fine, her infection was under control before we sent her to the transplant center for a transplant. So from the time that she came, in a week's time, her transplant was done. By that time, we had found out who was the likely donor, whose blood group was matching, and she survived. We still didn't have a diagnosis in her whether this was autoimmune or this was Wilson's. When they removed that liver of hers and they did a histology on that, they also were not sure whether this was Wilson's or this was autoimmune. But this child is doing well, and this child survived and has gone back to Rajasthan. So she was a decompensated liver disease and she's done well after she's gone the transplant. So this was one indication where you need a transplant urgently.
What would be your level of PTINR?
We actually have a PEL scoring system. Like in adults they have a MEL scoring system, in children we have a PEL scoring system which helps us to decide. So it's not based only on PTINR. Okay. It's also based on the growth, it's also based on the bilirubin and the albumin. And then we do a scoring and then we find out how soon should we go for a transplant. So this child had a low albumin, she had a rising bilirubin, she had a PTINR that continued to remain. So we needed to send her for a transplant urgently.
But in adults we need somewhere around 2.
Yes.
Children also the same.
Yes, it's the same. Now, this is another one who came in June. This is a 6-year-old girl. She had fever for 2 months. Right hypochondriac pain for 15 days, jaundice for 12 days, high colored urine, ascites for 10 days. So she's come as an acute presentation to us because jaundice is only for 12 days. There's no bleeding manifestations, so there's no altered sensorium. She's never had previous episodes of jaundice, so she seems to be something acute. There's no history of jaundice in the family. She has two younger sibs, both are normal. When we examined her, vitally she was stable, she had jaundice, she had pedal edema. She had a liver which was palpable, so there was a hepatomegaly. It was not a shrunken liver. The spleen was 2 cm. She had ascites. Her CNS was normal. She also had a urine which showed pus cells. Liver did show co-seco texture with splenomegaly, but it was not a cirrhotic liver. She had autoimmune markers positive. Her ANA was 1:320. Ceruloplasmin was low and 24 hours urine copper was high. Now we do get this problem in children where always it becomes very difficult to differentiate Wilson's versus autoimmune. Here you have markers of autoimmune, ANA positive. You do have IgG on the elevated side, but you also have markers of Wilson's because ceruloplasmin is low and 24 hours urine copper is high. There's no KF ring. The only way to prove would have been a biopsy, but we were not able to do biopsy in this child because of her status that she had come in. So this was the gradual, we've been doing her liver function test almost on every 2 or 3 days. When she came, you can see that she came with 7.3 and she had an INR of 2.1. Over a period of time, her INR has continued to rise. Her bilirubin continued to rise and her albumin started dropping. So she was either an autoimmune or a Wilson's. Fulminant hepatic failure. So she came as an acute presentation and going into a fulminant hepatic failure. This child we advise about liver transplant that you need to go because if you don't do a transplant, and mind you, these children are well, they are sitting up on the bed, they are talking to you. You are telling them, look, this child will die if you don't do a liver transplant. it's very difficult for parents to accept that, that this child is not in the ICU, this child is doing well, why are they talking about transplant? This child was counseled, this child died after a month. They took the child home. And the child died at home 1 month later. So you have to be very careful when, because just because the child is sitting up on the bed does not mean the child does not require a liver transplant. Gradually over a period of time you have to see the trend. Yeah, because she had portal hypertension. So you have to be very careful. This child was again Nanavati patient. I remember this child was in the general ward. And we had to tell the parents, look, get the transplant done. They didn't believe us that the child needs a transplant. And a month later, he came back with the two younger SIBs to get them checked for Wilson's. And he said that the older child has died. So this is another situation where you need an urgent transplant. So my, now you come to that case of yours where you need a PTINR, very important. Now this was another child that I had, 2.5-year-old, diagnosed to have tyrosinemia. He was put on a tyrosine low diet, he had renal tubular acidosis. Tyrosinemia patients are very prone to get hepatocellular carcinoma. His alpha fetoprotein in December 2011 was on the higher side, 4314. At that time he didn't have any signs of malignancy. In 2012, his succinyl acetone acetate was elevated, his alpha fetoprotein was normal. We started him on this NTBC, that's a pathway blocker. It prevents the formation of the succinyl acetoacetate, which is the one that causes the carcinoma.
Normal alpha fetoprotein 4500?
No, no, it was elevated for him.
What is normal?
It varies from age group. So alpha fetoprotein, in neonates it's very high. Then it gradually comes down and it varies. By the time this child should have had less than 15, not 15, 15.5. So this NTBC is not available in India. We have to order it from abroad. And by the time we could arrange the NTBC for this child, it was September 2012. In December 2012, we were continuously monitoring the alpha fetoprotein. The alpha fetoprotein rose to 25,000. So we knew now there is a malignancy somewhere. Ultrasound showed a focal lesion in the liver. We did an ultrasound guided biopsy which showed hepatocellular carcinoma. Now this child, we counseled about liver transplant because there was no way that this child is going to survive without a transplant. So initially the mother was worked up, both the mother's and the father's blood group was matching. Initially the mother was worked up for the feasibility of transplant. She was found to have a fatty liver and that was a contraindication for her liver transplant. So finally the father had to donate the liver. So by the time the entire liver transplant process took place, it was 3 months. So they had to actually cut off the arterial supply to the lesion so that the lesion does not increase. So here we had time to do everything, work up the child properly, work up the father properly, the donor properly, and get the transplant done. Now this transplant was not done in Mumbai. So we could also decide the surgeon that we wanted for the transplant because ultimately everything depends on the expertise of the surgeon. Who has the highest expertise in doing liver transplant in pediatrics? Who can manage metabolic liver disease or who can manage different kinds of liver disease? So a lot of transplant, you must know who's the transplant team getting involved. It's not the center that is important. What is important is who's the surgeon, what experience the surgeon has with the pediatric liver transplant. And whether this, because you're getting into a program where you want 100% success. You're not doing this as an experiment. So you want 100% success. You don't want somebody who's going to die or, all those kind of complications. Now, each transplant that has taken place has actually cost them anywhere from 17 lakhs to 25 lakhs. So that's the cost for a pediatric liver transplant. Second, all of these patients will be on lifelong immunosuppression. So the cost of monthly immunosuppression would also come to around 8 to 15,000 rupees. So it's not a very, it's an expensive program to get into. So you want to do it at a center which gives you a best outcome. Now all these patients whom I've counseled about liver transplant, fortunately none of the patients have died who got a transplant done because the indication for the transplant was very clear and we had selected the right candidate for a transplant.
Now,
NTBC is orphanidin. It's a pathway blocker which prevents conversion of tyrosine to succinyl acetoacetate. So it prevents that carcinogenic. Urine succinyl acetoacetate is carcinogenic, so it prevents that.
Okay. But then how long?
You are supposed to give it lifelong. No, I'm getting it free for my patients. So they only pay for the at the custom, whatever they have to pay, 1,000 rupees or something. But the problem is it has to be maintained in cold storage. So when it's couriered also, it has to be maintained in cold storage. So it has to come to their home in the next 3 days once it's couriered.
And frequency?
You have to give it lifelong. So I order medicines for 6 months.
But means daily? You give it, it's an injectable?
No, it's a tablet. It's a capsule.
Oh, every day? Yes.
Every day.
So the next capsule? Follow.
The NTBC is in the form of a capsule.
But what is NTBC exactly?
It's a full form. You can remember orphanidin. It's a molecular name that I gave you, NTBC. But it's orphanidin. It's not available in India.
Catalyst or enzyme or something?
Pardon?
Catalyst or enzyme. Stopping the metabolic transformation.
Yeah, it prevents the formation of the urine succinyl acetoacetate. Now this I wanted to discuss. Now we actually come to cases where transplant should not be done. This was a 7-month-old. He was referred to a transplant center for liver transplant. This child had neonatal cholestasis with jaundice right from day 15 of life, and now the jaundice was increasing. Any neonatal cholestasis which is not coming under control, ultimately they go for a transplant. So father was ready to donate the liver. These parents are from Surat. They had come down to Mumbai for a liver transplant, already father ready to donate. The workup at the transplant center, because they wanted to know what's the primary diagnosis, what is the chances of recurrence in the transplanted liver. So they did the ultrasound, they did a metabolic workup, they found nothing. They did an echocardiography and that showed pulmonary artery stenosis. They had planned the transplant next week. Somehow the father was a little jittery and he came to me for a second opinion. So we got an echo repeated here. Again an anomaly which showed a high pulmonary pressures and a very long segment pulmonary artery stenosis. So the cardiologist spoke to me that we need to know how the pulmonary vessels are before we go in for a transplant. We got a CT angio done and both the pulmonary arteries were stenosed right till the periphery. So I spoke to the transplant team. I said he has bilateral pulmonary artery stenosis right till the periphery. How are you going to tackle it? So they said we'll do a balloon angioplasty and open the stenosis. So I said how will you do a balloon angioplasty for an entire 3 cm segment? It's not possible. Then I spoke to the cardiologist. They said this child will die on table if you go ahead with a transplant. There's no way a balloon angioplasty can also be done. So he's an absolute contraindication for a liver transplant. Here we would have wasted the father's liver, we would have wasted the money, and this child would have undergone a procedure which would have been life threatening. Anyway, this child is not going to survive, but he would have died much earlier. So here when I spoke to the parents, I said, take your child back home. There's no way that we can get a transplant done.
It was difficult.
It was not possible in this child. Bilateral, peripheral pulmonary artery stenosis, nothing possible. You just had to...
Any cause for effect?
It was congenital. Yeah, it was congenital. So most probably this child had a syndrome called Alagille syndrome, which can cause this pulmonary artery stenosis as well as the liver neonatal cholestasis.
What
did
the child
have? What the syndrome?
Alagille syndrome. We didn't prove it. Because we didn't do the test. We just counseled him, take the child back home. So here, the transplant center had posted him next week for the transplant. Okay, there is a lot of pressure because transplant is you're paying a lot of money to the surgeons and the transplant team, and the hospital has to recover the costs. So there's a lot of pressure to get a lot of transplants done. And that's the reason why when you all see the patient, they'll be coming to you for opinions. You all will have to be very, very careful about what you tell them, whether a transplant is required or not required. And it...
But you keep saying that in this case?
Yeah, put it once again.
But I mean, neonates, some surgical anomalies, anatomical, they can cause jaundice.
Yes.
So they have to be ruled out.
Yes. So you need to know the cause first before you plan a transplant. You just can't do liver transplant in any patient who's in failure or anything. You need to find out the cause as far as possible. Now this was another patient that I had. This was a very interesting case. This was a 1.5-year-old girl. She had abdominal distension. Only abdominal distension. She got admitted for abdominal distension. She had a hepatomegaly. ultrasound done shows these hypoechoic areas in the liver with cystic changes. We couldn't figure out what it was, so we did a USG guided biopsy of those lesions and they turned out to be histiocytosis. So she didn't have jaundice when she came in March 2012, no jaundice. She had these lesions in the liver on biopsy proven to be histiocytosis. She was started on treatment with etoposide and steroids. At that time, she didn't have any skeletal involvement or a bone marrow involvement. She was okay. 4 months later, she started getting jaundice. This time, an MRCP was done in October 2012, which revealed this dilatation of the intrahepatic biliary tree. Repeat liver biopsy was done to know whether the histiocytosis has worsened. It didn't pick up histiocytosis at that time. But what it did show was a sclerosing ductal disease in the right lobe of the liver. Now this is a complication of histiocytosis. The sclerosing ductal disease is a part of histiocytosis, but the biopsy markers for histiocytosis were negative. Now the only treatment here actually is a liver transplant. If the histiocytosis is not responding to your chemotherapy, and the jaundice is worsening and causing this ductal disease, then you need to do a liver transplant. So I'm showing you the liver function test over a period of time from March to October. In March, her bilirubin was 0.6. Gradually, the bilirubin has been rising, and in October, it was 5.4. Liver functions were always abnormal right from beginning, and they remained the same, HGOT, SGPT. Her albumin was initially okay, and then it started dropping to 2.9. What is important is she always had this alkaline phosphatase on the higher side and GGTP on the higher side, telling us that there was a problem with the biliary tree. So this was a liver function test, and gradually, because the jaundice was rising and chemotherapy was apparently seeming not to be working, we counseled her for liver transplant. The day I spoke to them about liver transplant, the parents flew to Delhi on their own. We still had to, you know, find out whether this LCH histiocytosis had spread anywhere. So we were still getting a PET scan done to find out whether there's any lesion that is spread. This child decided to go on their own to Delhi. He went and met the surgeons, the transplant team there. Father said he will be the donor. And there was an ad in Mumbai Mirror from this center saying that they are going to transplant a histiocytosis patient, and they need funds for the transplant, and this is the first time in India that they are going to do a transplant. So there was an ad in the paper and they wanted funds for all that. By that time the PET scan report came, and the PET scan showed that there was a lesion in the skull. So that means that this histiocytosis had spread, and this was absolutely no way that we were going to do a transplant. So again I am coming to the thing that the transplant center posted him for transplant, put an ad in the paper saying that they need the funds to do a transplant without working up about the disease spread. We had to call up the surgeon and say, look, his PET scan is showing a met in the skull. How are you going to do it? That's when they called off the transplant, and the father came back and we asked him, why did you do like this something? He said he wanted to go on his own and get it done as fast as possible. So this is another situation where not a proper workup done, just because he had that jaundice rising and requiring a transplant, it was planned. And this is another situation. These are all live examples that I'm giving you. In children, getting an ERCP done is very, very difficult, and a stent is absolutely not possible in children.
LCH was already diagnosed.
Yes. They wanted to do, because the treatment of this LCH, which is only located to the liver, is liver transplant.
Yeah.
And it's very, very rare condition. But this was not the time to do that, because there was a spread. There's a lot of pressure about transplant. And the moment you utter the word transplant, they want to jump onto that. So you have to be very careful. Now this child, I want you to know. This child came to me on 29 June. I saw the child straight in the ICU. He came at 3 p.m. to the hospital. 1.5-year-old boy, only child. Very precious child, had been born after many, many years of marriage. He had jaundice for 20 days. He had fever for 9 days. He was irritable for a day. And he had received paracetamol in appropriate doses for his fever. So we had an acute hepatitis here. And this child came straight into the ICU because he was altered at that time. He was irritable. He was hypotensive. He was hypoglycemic. So he was hypotensive, hypoglycemic. He had to be in the ICU. In the ICU was jaundice, he had pedal edema, his liver was just palpable, spleen was not palpable. He had hypertonia and wrist reflexes. This is in the casualty. By the time he came to the IPCU, he was decortical, decerebrating, this child. So the diagnosis at that time was fulminant hepatic failure with hepatic encephalopathy. Investigations wise, liver was normal echotexture, so it tells us it was nothing chronic, it was something that was acute. All the viral markers, dengue, lepto, malaria, hep B, vidal, A, hepatitis A, E, all were negative. We thought of paracetamol poisoning, but paracetamol also was given in appropriate doses. So what I want to do is, this child had jaundice for 20 days. He was following up with one doctor who has been seeing these markers. He has been seeing the bilirubin. Bilirubin has gone from 3.2, 8.4, 11.8. Enzymes have been falling in this child. Okay, with the bilirubin rising and enzymes falling, you're worried. They told the parents, he'll get okay, take him home. Okay, so they lost that precious time. From 18 to 26, they lost this time. Nobody did a PTINR, not done. On 29th, when he came to the hospital, straight away, PTINR is 6.5. His bilirubin has gone up from 11 to 17, and his albumin is 3.1. Albumin has still not fallen that bad, but his PTINR has gone to 6.5. He is in fulminant hepatic failure. This child's liver has shrunken now because liver is just palpable. Any acute hepatitis, you would have expected a large liver. And now he's got a CNS involvement, cerebral edema. He's gone into decerebration. So he was started on IV antibiotics, IV fluids, N-acetylcysteine, hepatic NKF management, FFP, platelets, all that. By 3 o'clock when he came, he was irritable, Glasgow schema, coma scale and coma. 2 hours later, he's decerebrating, shifted to ICU, put on phenobarb. 4 a.m., he's put on ventilator. So by afternoon to next day morning, he's put on ventilator and requires mannitol for raised ICT. 9:30, I see the patient in the morning, and I tell the parents that he's got a bad outcome. Liver transplant is not possible in this child because by now the brain is involved. He's got raised ICT. This is a contraindication for a liver transplant. So parents knew that the child is dying, precious child for them. They called up somebody of their relatives in Dubai or somewhere. They said, take the patient to a transplant center, let's get a transplant done. So they went Dharma, discharge against medical advice. 7:30 in the evening, they take the patient to the transplant center. There, a CT brain is done, it shows cerebral edema. He's given anti-cerebral edema measures for 48 hours. His Glasgow coma scale continues to be 4 or 5. Mother, she's on antipsychotics, donates the liver. Child's blood group is AB positive, mother's blood group is B. Post-transplant, 48 hours later, this child goes into status epilepticus. He is put on 6 anticonvulsants, doesn't come under control. MRI post-transplant shows vast cystic changes in the brain. Child's transplant liver-wise, successful, brain-wise, not successful. And they are left behind with a CP chair. Okay, again when I spoke to the transplant team, I said, we had told these parents that they are not supposed to go for a transplant. Why did you transplant? So the explanation given to us was, we thought that the edema, anti-edema measures that we gave for 48 hours should be enough to get the edema under control and do a transplant. But by that time, the brain was damaged. It was already damaged. So this child should not have undergone a transplant. Ammonia was high in this child. So it was high. So there was no question that this child should have undergone a transplant.
What was the cause of the transplant?
No idea. So a transplant has been done in this child. This is one transplant which we could not. This would come as a transplant in their statistics, it would come as a transplant success. Okay. So now I'm going to tell you about why you have to be very, very careful about liver transplant. This is live donor program, don't play around. There's a lot of money involved, yes, but there's a lot of mortality and morbidity involved. So be very, very careful. This is a 16-year-old boy with chronic kidney disease, now being planned for renal transplant. Mother is considering to be a donor. child is HPSAG positive, and the kidney transplant unit wants to know whether the child can undergo a renal transplant with a hepatitis B that is positive in this child. Currently, from liver point of view, is absolutely normal. There's no portal hypertension, ultrasound normal, liver function test normal. So the question that came to us is, would you allow a liver transplant in a hepatitis B positive individuals? In olden days, we would say it was an absolute contraindication. Now with proper control of hepatitis B, you could advise a renal transplant. There will be a flare of hepatitis B the moment the child goes on immunosuppression post renal transplant. But if you control the disease, it's not a contraindication. So this is one where you could go ahead with a, when the first reaction would be no. The reaction here would be yes. Okay, so that's the end of the talk.